Thomas Jefferson, one of America's founding fathers, invented the first swiveling mechanism for office chairs. Decades later, Charles Darwin added casters to his chair to roll it around the study as he worked on the theory of evolution. Today, office chairs still swivel and roll, but they've evolved. The first part of the process is to make the bottom cushion frame by bending 14-gauge steel tubing into shape. The ends are joined, and then steel bars are welded across the middle. These will support the mechanism for adjusting the position of the seat. Steel springs are then fitted that lie from the front to the back of the seat frame. These sinuous springs will provide a flexible web of suspension in the seat. For additional stability and support, rods are placed across the springs. These are clipped into place, completing the seat frame. Here the chair's back frame is being built. It includes a lumbar support and steel supports to later attach the armrests. All the burrs and rough edges are ground before the next stage. In the upholstery department, a leather hide is smoothed out on a cutting table in preparation for the cutting process. Using templates, the patterns are then cut out. This process involves working around the natural flaws in the hide to ensure there is minimal waste. It also means that the factory will be able to cut all of the leather pieces for one chair from one hide. This is important because colour and grain can vary from hide to hide, and so it ensures that the final chair will have a consistent look and texture. Once all the leather pieces are accrued, it's onto the foam cushioning used for the backing. The density of the foam in the chair varies. More rigid foam is used for the chair's contoured cushioning. This is because it will hold its shape better. Softer and thicker foam is used for the part of the chair that the occupant's back rests against, into which slits are cut, which are a design feature. Corresponding lines are then drawn onto the leather in chalk. The chalk lines are aligned with the slits in the foam. And as they're stitched together, the leather is puckered to form a ribbed pattern in the upper half of the chair's upholstery. For many of the other pieces, the padding is stitched flat to the back of the leather. This piece is a side panel for the back of the chair. Stitched to either side of the back piece are casings that will form side supports. To complete the back of the chair, a chipboard panel is added, and the entire structure is encased with foam, then covered with leather upholstery. After the seat has been upholstered, a plastic cover is screwed to the underside to enclose it. A sliding plate is then screwed to the base. Attached next is the mechanism that works in conjunction with the plate to slide the seat backwards and forwards. It also has features for adjusting the tilt and height of the seat. Next, the hydraulic cylinder that raises or lowers the seat is fitted. Not only is it the chair's stem, it also swivels, allowing the chair to rotate 360 degrees. Attached to the cylinder is the chair's aluminium base, into which the casters are snapped into place. The office chair is then fitted with a car-style headrest, whose prongs fit into brackets in the frame. Finally, the armrests are locked into the frame. This office chair is now ready for a situation when sitting down on the job is perfectly acceptable. Vinobrew does exactly what it says on the tin. Well, bottle. Vino meaning wine and brew referring to beer is a hybrid drink where breweries and wineries have merged their otherwise two separate worlds to create a unique blend. And in this case, there's a third ingredient. This Vinobrew is made from a port-style sweet wine, a dark strong beer or stout, plus one other brewed ingredient, coffee. It's the collaborative creation of a winery, a microbrewery, and a coffee producer. The microbrewery grows 20 different varieties of hops, whose flowers contain the resins and essential oils that give beer its bitter and aromatic characteristics. To begin the beer-making process, a tank, or mash tun, is filled with water. Then a burner is ignited underneath. When the water reaches 65 degrees Celsius, a blend of different types of malts are tipped in. Malts are cereal grains, such as barley or corn, that have been soaked to start germination. Then once sprouted, dried with hot air to halt that germination. Stirring the malt in the hot water activates enzymes that convert the starches in the grain into fermentable sugars. After about an hour, the liquid, called wort, is transferred into the boil kettle, into which different types of hops are added. The wort is brought to the boil to kill off harmful bacteria and sterilize it. Next, the wort is cooled and moved to the fermentation tank, where yeast is added. Over the next 10 to 14 days, the yeast consumes the fermentable sugars in the wort, converting them into alcohol and producing carbon dioxide gas, which creates bubbles, thus transforming the wort into beer. Over at the coffee company, after coming out of the roaster, the hop beans must be cooled quickly so they don't overcook. This perforated cooling pan stirs them to help dissipate the heat. Once cooled, the beans are ground into coarse coffee. To prepare the coffee for Vinobrew, the ground beans are put into a filter bag, which is then submerged in water. It's left to steep for 16 hours, after which the filtered coffee is collected in a jar. At the winery, grapes are harvested and pressed. Yeast is added and they're left to ferment. The port wine is then aged for at least 2 years in oak barrels. To decide which wines to use for the Vinobrew, samples are tested from different barrels to check acidity and sweetness. Next, it's all down to taste, as both the coffee and winemaker experiment with quantities of the wines and coffees made from various types of beans. But the main ingredient is the beer. It's as much art as it is science. For each batch of Vinobrew, the selection of ingredients and proportions are played with. And each batch is tested and smelt to evaluate its aroma, sweetness, bitterness, and acidity. The idea is to create a harmonious blend of the three elements, producing a new flavor, without one ingredient dominating the other. Once they've found that winning formula, it's replicated on a large scale for production. The chosen wine is pumped from storage tanks into barrels, then transported to the brewery. At the brewery, the required amount of wine is then pumped from the barrels into a blending tank. Next added is the required quantity of coffee. Finally, the beer is pumped into the tank. Beer forms the largest portion of the recipe, followed by wine and then coffee. After the ingredients are blended, they're pumped into a beer keg. Carbon dioxide is then injected, adding more carbonation. When you pour a glass, the bubbles rise to the top, producing a foam or head. But that's as close as it gets to looking like a regular beer. One sip of this is a unique experience for your taste buds.